So the other one is Noah's Ark. How do you look at Noah's Ark in light of modern science? From my understanding, you believe there was a local flood that wiped out all humans except for 8 saved on an ark. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's the view I would take, is that the flood described in Scripture is a real historical event, and that Noah and his wife and 3 sons and their wives were the sole survivors, that the flood impacted all of humanity.
Now, the most obvious question I have on that is, why would all of humanity be in one spot? I mean, even you yourself in debates have said that, you know, you talk about this migration of humans, you know, out of Africa and all this. It's not like people left Africa as a group and stayed together. There would have been people leaving and people staying and people spreading out all over the place. So it just seems inconceivable that people would be in one local area to be killed in a flood.
Yeah, well, I mean, when you look at the origin of humanity, there does appear to be, from the scientific data, a geographical region where humanity does have its genesis, and that humanity does migrate from that area outward. And so when you look at the migration patterns, there is a fanning out that takes place from a point of origin. And so I would argue that the genetic data and the archaeological data and even paleolinguistics all point to the idea that there is a fanning out of humanity that fan has its center at or near the Middle East.
So is that from Noah's Ark or is that from Adam and Eve, you're saying?
Well, I would say that migration would reflect an event that happened after the flood. So I would, you know, use the scientific data to estimate the time of the flood mm-hmm. as being in the 50,000 to 60,000 year range, given that's what the scientific data seems to indicate. There's nothing in the biblical text that really gives us, I think, a strong clue as to when that migration would have happened.
Well, let me ask you some simple questions now. If so, you're saying the flood was probably about 50,000 years ago?
Yes.
And it was a local flood. How local is it? Is it covering like 5 miles or 500 miles or what?
It would basically have covered the general area of Mesopotamia. I mean, people that hold to a progressive creation view and a local flood view, I think, would have some debate as to exactly what the extent of the flood is, but it would be largely confined to, the Mesopotamia area.
Now, and why wouldn't other humans have boats to get out of this? I mean, what's so hard about getting in a boat, and if it's a local flood, just to go somewhere else?
Well, if it was a dramatic event where, the waters rose rather quickly, then there wouldn't have been time for people to escape. That would be essentially the argument.
Well, if they had fisher boats, I mean, if they knew how to fish, is that before people had boats? People invented boats, and this is like the first boat. Noah invented the first boat,
or I mean, in a sense, I don't know the answer to that question.
I mean, because
I would just simply go by in that juncture what Scripture is saying, that Noah is building this, very large boat. But part of the process of building that boat is he was essentially preaching the coming judgment on humanity. And so the boat was, again, rather massive. I've not really spent time studying specifically the size of the dimensions of the boat and that type of thing. But it was clearly a rather significant undertaking.
And why would he save birds if it was a local flood? I mean, birds, it seems like they could easily fly to higher ground, I would think.
Yeah, well, I mean, the process of, taking animals on board the ark was not meant to save those animals, but rather is meant to have creatures on board that Noah and his family would use to reestablish civilization after they, came off of the boat. And the animals that were taken on board the boat were either for, again, reestablishing civilization, or they would have been used for sacrifice purposes.
Do you think he took all the local animals, like the snakes and the turtles or frogs and salamanders and all that?
No, actually, when you examine the text in Genesis 6 through 9, the flood account, it's very clear from the text when you read it in the original Hebrew that Noah was bringing very specific types of animals on board the ark. It wasn't every creature. There were specific types of creatures that were designed to fulfill a function of either survive, you know, helping Noah and his family to survive on the ark and survive after the flood event took place, and a creature that they would use for sacrifice or for religious purposes.
Well, it doesn't seem like, do you believe that the flood happened like for over a year, according to the Bible?
Yeah, I mean, I would take what the Bible says at face value.
He had such few animals on there, that wouldn't even be enough to last a week. I mean, if he was going to eat them on board.
Well, I don't know that it says that he ate them, but those animals were there on board, again, to reestablish civilization, or that there would be creatures that he would use while he was on board the ark for survival. It doesn't mean that they were necessarily eating those creatures.
Okay, any last statements before we go into the next section?
I would say that when you look at the biblical account of the flood, oftentimes people think of this in terms of a global flood, but there are a number of Christians who would look at it as a real historical event that involved a local flood, and that there is scientific data that is consistent with the spread of humanity after the flood event.
What's the most obvious reason that it was not a global flood?
For example, if you look at passages like Psalm 104, which is a creation account, when it describes the creation of land, which would have corresponded to the third day of creation in Genesis 1, it talks about the land being produced and that there was a boundary that was created at the time that the land was produced over which the waters would never again overwhelm. And so the passages like Psalm 104, for example, when they again are referring to the creation of the land, make it very clear that the earth was never going to return to a water world again, as it was described in Genesis 1:2, and then reiterated in Psalm 104. So that would be one reason why I would say that it has to be a local flood, not a global flood.
Well, do you think it's also obvious that there's no physical evidence of a worldwide flood, and if there was one, there'd be marks all over the place, and there's no marks of it?
Yes, I mean that would be another reason. Is that for example, there's not enough water on the planet to cover the Earth, to cover the entire surface of the Earth, and so. Yeah, there's a number of reasons, scientific reasons, why the flood simply couldn't be a global flood.
Yeah, plus, so all the animals on the ark and all that.
Right. So it does factor into the, into the argument that it was a local flood, not a global flood.
Okay.
But on the other hand, there's plenty of clues in the text that are that suggest that it was a local flood, and you wind up with incoherencies with other passages of Scripture that deal with creation when you argue it's a global flood as opposed to a local flood. So in order to maintain consistency in interpreting all the scriptural passages that relate whether directly or indirectly to the flood account, you have to adopt a local flood interpretation.
Okay, so let's go on to the next section.